So we will move on to the other welding processes. So we looked at arc welding process, GTW, JMW, and then resistance spot welding. In arc welding, we also looked at variants of the arc welding processes, the resistance welding processes, resistance spot weld, flash bud, resistance upset, right, percussion welds, then laser welds, electron beam welds. So we move on to the other welding processes, right. So this will take 2 or 3 classes, and then we look at in last class the welding positions and the typical weld designs we use in engineering applications, and then we wind up, okay. So first, in other welding processes, we have 4 more classes, okay. So the electroslag welding, okay. So electroslag welding is widely used for a large cross section welds, like I showed you in electron beam welding, okay. So in one slide of 150 millimeter, okay. So if you are one weld in such a large cross section, and we can use electroslag welding. And electroslag welding is actually invented in US, but only Russians, the former USSR, they commercialized and they made it to various applications in electroslag welding. And it is basically a casting process, okay. It is not a welding, but you melt so much volume and then you progressively solidify when you go up, right. So we look at electroslag welding. And then it is aluminothermic welding. What is aluminothermic welding? It is one of the oldest welding processes, okay. So even now we use it for our railways, okay. And it is absolute technology in Western worlds, but our rails are still welded with aluminothermic, okay. And then the magnetically impelled arc bud weld, MIAB we call it. And this is a very useful process to weld pipelines. Okay, so MIAB welding, it is widely used and it is extremely efficient to weld pipes of wall thicknesses more than 20 mm or so. So and then we will move on to the solid state welding processes, friction and friction stir, ultrasonic welding, explosive, diffusion welding, high frequency stud welding, and then cold forming, cold pressure welding, okay. And these are all solid state welding process or non-welding, non-fusion welding processes, because we do not melt, okay. So we will do the welding in solid state, right. And in MIAB process, MIAB is both, we melt and we also apply some upsetting force, same as in a flash bud weld, okay. There is some difference between flash bud and the MIAB, we will see when we are looking at this process, right. So first is electroslag welding. Okay. So electroslag welding is widely used for thicker sections. So the process works like this, okay. So we have a filler material, isn't it. So this is the wire filler, right. And filler is actually first fed into the weld cavity. So this is the interface to be welded, okay. So this is the interface to be welded. And the filler is first sent, and the filler is connected to the power source, and the workpiece also connected to the power source. So we use a DC current, most likely in most of the cases is the direct current, okay. And then at the start of the weld, we strike an arc between the filler and the base material, the interface, right. So the arc is there to melt initially, but the moment we arc is struck, we will start adding fluxes to the weld cavity, okay. So with the arc heat, the flux would start melt and then form slag, okay. So if we start adding the flux powders, the moment the filler wire strike an arc with the weld interface, you add fluxes inside, and then the flux would start melting with the heat of the arc. The slag will form, and then the slag melts, because it is molten slag, the flux melts and the slag forms. So the molten slag would start filling up. And the moment it comes in contact with the electrode tip, arc extinguishes, because there is a continuous contact, right. So the arc would extinguish, but you still pass the current, right. The current is still passed, so the slag would start heating up by resistance heating, right. It is clear, yes or no? Okay, so you have a weld cavity, something like this. I'll just simplify for you. Okay, so you add first the filler inside, and then the filler is connected to the power source, and then the workpiece also connected to power source. Say for example, negative and positive, make an electrode negative. Okay, so you have direct current, and then you strike an arc between the work pieces, and the moment you strike an arc, you add flux powders inside. So this flux powder, because of the heat of the arc, will start melting and form a slag, and you form a layer. So the moment the electrode is filled with the molten slag, the arc would extinguish, but you still pass a current, and that current is now used to melt the flux and form a slag, and then continuously the slag would melt the electrode, right, because it is molten, heated up, right. So the slag temperature will be more than 3000 Kelvin, okay, and then that heat would melt the filler, and then the filler would melt, and then you will deposit, and the slag would always float, isn't it? Slag is a less density than the molten metal, so slag will float away, and the liquid metal will go because of the density difference. It will fill the cavity, and you keep on adding fluxes, and the slag would melt, and the slag, molten slag, will protect the molten pool, and then you can continuously feed the wire to create more amount of volume of liquid metal, and the resistance heating would melt the fluxes to form a slag continuously. And then the molten liquid metal would start filling the weld cavity, right, it is clear. And because the welding, the melting of the filler is carried out by the slag, okay, and the slag is formed by the fluxes which are resistance heated, is not it? So that is why it is known as electroslag welding. Slag melts the filler, okay, the filler fills the weld cavity, and then the slag is kept at higher temperature by resistance heating. The heating by the resistance of the slag, which is actually formed by the decomposition of the flux, right. So that is why this process is known as electroslag welding. So you need to always have some sort of container, this is known as a dam. Okay, so this is generally copper shoes, so water gold copper shoes kept between the weld cavity to contain the liquid, right, because the amount of liquid you melt and generate, the both the molten filler as well as the slag, it is so high, and you see that under the wall thickness, it is easily say 15 centimeter, and you can weld it in a single pass, because you can choose a filler wire in such a way that you have enough material, enough wire is molten to fill the weld cavity, and then subsequently you can add fluxes to protect the molten metal, and it is like a sequential casting, okay. So the molten liquid metal is generated, and then it is contained between the wall of the water cooled copper shoes, so that is like in a mold, isn't it? So the mold, liquid metal is poured, and then you move the liquid metal from the bottom to the top, and you solidify liquid metal and form the weld. Yes, it's clear. So this the mold, or the in this case we call it copper shoes, they are water cooled because they shouldn't melt, isn't it? So the trick over here is the you strike an arc in the first with the filler and the base material. And then you melt the fluxes by the heat of the arc, you form a slag, slag moment touches the filler wire, arc extinguishes, but then there is a contact, okay, the current is still passed, so the resistance heating would start maintaining the temperature of the slag, you add more and more fluxes, you form more and more slag, and the wire is also continuously fed to the weld cavity, so you melt more liquid metal, and the liquid metal it goes down and slag comes up because of the density difference, and then you can move the copper shoes sequentially once the bottom material solidifies, because you extract the heat by the copper heat, copper water cooled copper shoes. Silicon metal solidifies and then you can sequentially move the copper shoes from the bottom to the top of the job. Yes, it's clear how it works, right? And because of the productivity, and this is advantage, yes, and if you are welding in a very high thickness material, then you can, yeah, weld it in a single pass. I mean, what do you mean by pass? It's a container holding a liquid and then you fill a container with the liquid metal and then you solidify, right? It's clear? Okay, good. Any question on this process? Okay, so these are some of the characteristics of the electroslag welding, as I said. So no arc, okay, slag is molten by resistance heating. The arc is struck at very beginning to generate the initial heat needed to decompose the flux to form a slag. The moment slag touches the electrode tip, arc extinguishes, and then subsequently only resistance heating of the flux and the slag will provide heat to melt the filler. Okay, so arc is employed only to melt the flux initially. Okay, so generally it is, the welds are made in a vertical position. So if you are doing other positions, you can't contain the liquid metal. Okay, okay. The joint edge melted and fused with the molten material, and they are contained by the copper shoes, the dams, what do you call it? Okay. And because we have the flux and the slag protecting the atmosphere, and the weld metal is completely protected from the atmosphere from oxidation. Okay, and we can achieve huge deposition rates. You can sometimes go up to 30 kilograms per hour. Okay.
Sir?
Yeah.
Initially the slag is decomposed by means of that arc only.
Yeah. So initially, at the beginning, the flux, because no, when you are adding just flux, the achieving resistance heating is, the efficiency is much lower. So flux is a powder. Okay. So initially you strike an arc so that the fluxes can be molten by the heat of the arc. Right, and then moment flux melts, decomposes, you form slag, and then slag starts flowing, reaching the electrode tip. The moment electrode tip is immersed in the slag, so obviously, then the arc extinguishes. Right, so you can achieve a huge deposition rate. So I just put 13 kilograms, but sometimes you can go up to 30 kilograms per hour, 30 kilograms of deposition, and if you are using multiple electrodes. Fillers generally, you know, it is also used in the multiple electrodes over a range, and it is like, you know, you are creating a cast structure.